This morning's platform, the worm at the core on the role of death in life. Fascinating. Our speaker this morning is Dr. Sheldon Solomon. Dr. Solomon is a professor of psychology at Skidmore College. His work exploring the effects of the uniquely human awareness of death on individual and social behavior has been supported by the National Science Foundation and the Ernest Becker Foundation, and was featured in the award-winning documentary film Flight from Death, Our Quest for Immortality. He is co-author of In the Wake of 9/11, The Psychology of Terror, and today's program, The Worm at the Core on the Role of Death. Dr. Solomon.
Thank you, and good morning. Can everybody hear the folks in the back? Thank you so much for having me today. Very pleasantly surprised to see such a big crowd and seemingly eclectic and diverse one at that. I'm here to tell you a little bit about the work that I do and hopefully some ideas that will be of interest in service of beginning an ongoing intellectual dialogue. And to get started, ever since antiquity, philosophers, theologians, just people sitting on a rock way back in the day, have gone to extraordinary lengths to try and capture what it is that is the essence of what it means to be a human being. And I know that all of you are familiar with the term Homo sapiens, which really comes from Aristotle's notion that we are uniquely rational and thereby wise animals. And let's sidestep in the interest of time whether or not we're actually worthy of that designation from time to time. And just note that is not the only way that humans have been characterized. At the beginning of the 20th century, an anthropologist called us Homo ludens, that we're playful animals. Some of you that may be familiar with Hannah Arendt's work, she called us Homo fabers, that we're tool-making, manufacturing animals. Another woman out in Seattle, Ellen Dizanayake, calls us Homo aestheticus, that we're aesthetic animals. We like to surround ourselves in a world of beauty. Just yesterday, I saw another one, a Swedish novelist, recently deceased, described us as Homo narratans, that we're storytelling animals. What I'd like to do is to propose another designation based on a phrase I saw in a short story by Alexander Smith, a Scottish writer in the 1860s, I believe. Smith said, "It is our knowledge that we have to die that makes us human." And in our book, we call us Homo Mortalis for that reason. And this is an idea that William James, a couple of decades after Smith, framed in biblical terms when he said that death is the worm at the core of the human experience. And I hope the biblical allusion makes sense. This is with reference to Eve gobbling on the apple from the tree of knowledge. And this is what brings the awareness of death into the world. A couple of decades, well, almost a century after William James, the cultural anthropologist Ernest Becker wins a Pulitzer Prize for his book, The Denial of Death. And what Becker did was to take that basic idea that the awareness of death and our really militant disinclination to accept that unwelcome fact underlies a substantial proportion of human activity. And what Becker did was to take both an evolutionary as well as an existential psychodynamic perspective in order to develop that basic idea in a way that I think is profoundly provocative and potentially important. And so let's start with Charles Darwin, who I know you're all familiar with, not having met him, but having been aware of his ideas. And let's start with the non-controversial Darwinian assumption that human beings, like all forms of life, have a basic biological predisposition towards survival, both in the interest of self-preservation as well as reproduction. Living things like to stay alive. Head shakes if you can accept that. This New York, which is fine. I was in St. Louis earlier this week, and that's a tougher one to get by. that's easy for most folks to accept. Pencil in the Origin of the Species, by the way, is the second chapter, the struggle for survival. But Darwin, not being a simpleton, also realized that although humans share with all forms of life a basic biological predisposition towards staying alive, there's lots of different ways of pulling off the most arduous feat of perpetuating one's kind over time. So, you know, beavers build dams, giraffes got the big neck, eagles got great eyesight, and so on and so forth. Well, what is it that we have going for us? And what Darwin pointed out, and I hope this is somewhat obvious, is that we're pretty smart, no grounds to be excessively arrogant, but we do have a big forebrain, which enables us to think both abstractly and symbolically to the point where humans and only humans can imagine something that does not yet exist, and then have the audacity to transform their dreams into reality. Again, who remembers, not because you were there, but because you learned it in school, Leonardo da Vinci scribbling pictures of helicopters in his notebooks in the 1500s. And of course, everybody said, this is madness, right? But isn't it profound that we are today routinely transported by what was originally denounced as the doodlings of a madman? And I like one of Freud's disciples, Otto Rank, who really put it in a pithy fashion when he said, only human beings make the unreal real. And I think it's, I hope, very obvious that this has served us well and why we're pretty much not only here today, but have proliferated over every inhabitable niche on the planet upon which we currently reside. Let's keep Darwin in mind and let's go backwards in time about, I don't know, 20 years or so. And let's talk about Søren Kierkegaard, the Danish existential philosopher. Before there was even psychology, Kierkegaard was at the vanguard when he realized that human beings are so smart that we actually realize that we exist. Not a trick question. Who's aware of the fact that you're here now listening to me or pretending to do so while you hallucinate about lunch? Anybody willing to? But you know that you're here. And Kierkegaard's point, we call this self-awareness, we call it consciousness these days. And the point that Kierkegaard makes is that we take consciousness for granted because we're surrounded by it. Who like me, you ever wake up in the morning and say, here I am, it's morning? You ever have one of those? Here I am walking down the street, thinking about that I'm walking down the street. Kierkegaard's point is that it takes a ridiculously sophisticated cognitive apparatus to render yourself the object of your own subjective inquiry. A rosebush exists but doesn't know that it does. A dung beetle exists but doesn't know that it does. Not going to argue with you about whether your dog knows that he or she exists. I just need you to grant that you know that you exist. All right, so those are our two assumptions. Living things like to stay alive, and you're so smart that you know that you're here. What Kierkegaard then does in a remarkable volume called Fear and Trembling, that I always recommend one buys for the in-laws coffee table, what Kierkegaard said is, you know, if you're smart enough to know that you're alive, you will necessarily experience two uniquely human emotions that he called awe and dread, respectively. And Kierkegaard's very hard, but awe and dread are pretty straightforward. So let's talk briefly, but not forget by any means how awesome it is to be alive. Who's ever woken up one day, nothing in particular happened, you didn't win a Nobel Prize, you didn't win the lottery, you just wake up and are sublimely appreciative to be alive. Who's ever had one of those moments? This is awesome. Because, as Kierkegaard points out, it doesn't get any better than that. That's why most of us, if we had to choose, would rather be people than pomegranates. We'd rather be people than porcupines. But we have the sublime and supreme privilege of being here and knowing that we're here. And if we had more time, I'd regale you with some literature. Who's ever read Ulysses or thought about it someday? In fact, I know you never got to the end unless you use it to keep your car from rolling downhill on your driveway. But who's ever gotten to the end? The last sentence of Ulysses, it's about 50 pages long, longest sentence in the history of English literature. And it starts and it ends with the same word. Yes, alive, awesome. Right, but Kierkegaard turns right around and he says, yeah, but it's dreadful to be alive and to know it, lest ye be either a child or cognitively impaired. If you're smart enough to know that you're here, you're also smart enough to realize that, like all living things, your life is of finite duration and that you too will someday die. I know you're pretty happy so far, and I hope I'm not the first one to break the news to you. But this is not a welcome realization. People, you keep lists of things to do, pay the cell phone bill, take out the dog, park the car, die. No, nobody has that on their to-do list, and for good reasons. And so Kierkegaard said, we are uncomfortable with the realization of the inevitability of death. Moreover, our discomfort at the prospect of dying, it is magnified by the concurrent recognition that not only will we someday die, but we could die at any time for reasons that we could never anticipate or control. And then just the knee-us in the psychological groin. What Ernest Becker does is to take an idea from Freud and point out that we don't like the idea that we're animals. Who has seen the Elephant Man film? Anybody see that film? Remember when the Elephant Man says, I am not an animal. Remember that? It's the highlight of the film. And you're like, go, Mr. Pachyderm, I'm with you, my friend. But he's wrong. He is an animal, as are you, a breathing piece of defecating meat that from a purely biological perspective is no more significant or enduring than a lizard or a potato. And according to Ernest Becker, if that's all we thought about, I'm going to die. I could walk outside and get hit by a comet. I'm a breathing piece of meat. I'm a talking sausage. I'm spam with a plan, but I've got no plan. But we would not be able to stand up in the morning, and you'd certainly not be sitting here with any modicum of psychological equanimity. You'd be a quivering blob of biological protoplasm, cowering under your chair, groping for sedatives the size of sport utility vehicles. And this raises the question, thanks to Woody Allen for that one, but this raises the question, how is it that humankind is able to function, psychologically speaking, day to day, in light of the reality of the human condition? And what Ernest Becker said is that our ancestors, rather cleverly and quite unconsciously, managed the existential terror that is engendered by the uniquely human awareness of death by the construction and maintenance of what the anthropologists call culture. Humanly constructed beliefs about the nature of reality that we share with other people in our group that minimize death anxiety by giving us each a sense that we are valuable individuals in a world of meaning. In a book called The Birth and Death of Meaning, what Ernest Becker asked us to think about is meaning and value. And I like Ernest Becker a lot because he doesn't rely on turgid jargon. We all know what meaning and value mean. But let's talk about meaning real quickly. Becker says, you know, I'm an anthropologist, and if you look at all of the cultures in the world, they may appear to be superficially different, but they all have common attributes. Every culture offers its denizens an account of the origin of the universe. Every culture has a prescription for how it is that we ought to behave while we're here. Every culture, moreover, has some hope of immortality, either literally through the heavens, the reincarnations, the souls, and the afterlives of the world's great religions, or symbolically, as the Greek philosophers pointed out, we may realize that we will not be here forever, but we are nevertheless comforted by the prospect that some vestige of our existence will persist over time, nevertheless, perhaps in the form of having children, perhaps in the form of amassing great fortunes and putting our name up all over buildings, airplanes, shopping malls, dogs, children. Perhaps by writing great books, perhaps by scientific discoveries, artistic creations. And so the point is that to stand up in the morning, we need to believe that life has meaning. Who's ever doubted that? You ever have a not so great day when you're like, I'm not so sure? You don't need to be a psychologist. What's the most common psychological disorder that results when we are unable to perceive that life has meaning?
Depression.
Depression, nicely done. And so for Becker, we need to feel that life has meaning. That's necessary but not sufficient. We need also to believe that each of us is a valuable individual in the context of the meaningful cosmological drama to which we subscribe. And the way that culture does that for us, sociology 101, it is to give us each social roles with associated standards that if we meet or exceed them, make us feel like we're persons of value in a world of meaning, right? So if you're a nurse, your job is to help people stay alive. Right, if you operate the guillotine, your job is to make sure that people don't stay alive. If you're a dog walker, well, dogs have to go out, you get the point, and so on and so forth. And then what Becker does is he says, okay, if you are lucky enough to be able to perceive yourself as a valuable person in a meaningful universe, he calls that self-esteem. And I know you've all heard that word before. It's the most common term in the psychological lexicon. And for Becker, self-esteem is the dominant motive of humankind, but let's not mistake that with narcissism. In fact, as we'll talk about a little bit down the trail, we have pathologically high levels of narcissism in our culture and an epidemic of low self-esteem. Those are two different things. If you're a legend in your own mind, that's not self-esteem, that's narcissism. We'll talk about that another time. All right, so that's basically what Ernest Becker says. We're so smart that we know that we're here. This makes us aware of the fact that we will die, that we could die at any time, and that you're a cold cut with an attitude. And this gives rise to potentially paralyzing terror that's mitigated by embracing cultural worldviews that give us a sense that we're valuable people in a meaningful universe. All right, two questions, and we're going to tackle them together. One question is, well, so what? All right, so maybe these ideas are true, right, but what does that buy us conceptually? In my world, we always talk about conceptual power. It's like, okay, what do we get? If we assume that these ideas are true, well, what can we understand that would be impossible to do otherwise? And then the second question is, well, how do we know that these ideas are true? Ernest Becker won a Pulitzer Prize for the denial of death, but was literally laughed out of the Academy. People just said, this is bullshit, if you'll pardon the expression. It's philosophical speculation based on a psychoanalytic tradition that has been thoroughly discredited. And this may be poetry, but it's not science, and therefore not worthy of our collective consideration. And so that's where we come in. When I say we, I mean myself and my two buddies from graduate school, Jeff Greenberg, now at the University of Arizona, Tom Kaczynski, now at the University of Colorado, at Colorado Springs. This is us now, as we're on the threshold of senility. But we met in the 1970s, before we looked like the cover of Jethro Tull album. But back in the day, we met in graduate school, and we thought these ideas were very exciting. And we've spent the last 35 years designing experiments to produce evidence that could test whether or not Becker was on the right track. And so what I want to do for the remaining time is to just tell you about a few areas of inquiry that I hope are of interest to you. And while we're doing that, I'll tell you a little bit about the studies that we've done. Let's start with man's proverbial inhumanity to man. Who's aware of the fact that humankind has an incredibly unsavory tendency to be unable to peacefully coexist with other people who don't share their beliefs about reality? And this is not of recent origin. Even the most benevolent glance at human history reveals an ongoing succession of genocidal atrocities juxtaposed with the brutal subjugation of designated in-house inferiors. And there's no evidence that this is about to change. Well, what Ernest Becker tells us in The Denial of Death is that this is in part a result of the fact that if our beliefs about reality serve to minimize death anxiety, whenever we run into somebody who's different, whether we're aware of it or not, we have a problem. Because if you accept the validity of an alternative conception of reality, you necessarily do so by undermining the confidence with which you subscribe to your own beliefs, and once that happens, you expose yourself to the very anxiety those beliefs were erected to mitigate in the first place. Head shakes if that makes sense, because that's as technical as we will get today, but it's very, very important, because the point that Becker makes is that the mere existence of people who are different is fundamentally threatening. All right, so I believe God created the earth in 6 days before taking a well-deserved break, union job, of course. But I also know that other people have different cosmologies. One of my favorites, because it's very beautiful, are the Borneo in the South Pacific. They believe that the earth was gestated out of a giant coconut that came from the side of a palm tree. All right, wow. Well, I'm going to Sunday school, I'm down with the Genesis story, and then I meet the coconut man, and so now what do? Well, according to Becker, the first thing that I do is to derogate or to demean the other person. Well, sure, that guy believes in a coconut story, but what an ignorant savage wearing a grass skirt, living in a tent, worshiping piles of sticks and mud. They don't have smartphones or Google, in which case they would surely join us in partaking of the truth. I hope you realize I'm being sarcastic here. In order to make an important point, and that is that when you denigrate the possessor of an alternative belief, you diminish the threat that it poses to your own. Right, while you're doing that, you try to get the other people to dispose of their beliefs and adopt yours instead. Christian missionaries are very good at that. But if that doesn't work, just kill those bastards. That's proving that your God and your beliefs are correct. After all, my God is better than your God, and we will kick your ass to prove it. All right, how do we know that this is what's actually happening? Jeff and Tom and I, 35 years ago, had an idea, and it's a very simple one. We just said, okay, let's assume that what Becker's saying is right, and then we said, let's do this. Let's create a situation where we remind some people of their mortality, and in a control condition, let's remind people of something unpleasant but not fatal, like breaking a leg, or having being in a car crash and having a limb amputated, going to the dentist and having a root canal, giving a talk in public and projectile vomiting on the people in the first row, thus diminishing your Facebook liking, and so on and so forth. And then we said, well, okay, if Becker's right, when you're reminded of your own mortality, that should make your need, psychologically speaking, for your beliefs greater, and we should be able to detect that by measuring your reactions to people who share your beliefs, or people who are opposed to them, or merely different. Right, so what we do this a lot of ways. Sometimes we bring people into the lab, and we just ask them, jot down your thoughts and feelings about yourself dying. Sometimes we have people fill out death anxiety questionnaires. Sometimes we show them in the lab videos of car crashes and other gruesome things. Sometimes we go outside of the lab and we stop people either in front of a funeral parlor or 100 meters to either side, thinking that if you're interviewed in front of a funeral parlor, that will have intimations of mortality enter your mind. Other times, we do something even more insidious. We call them subliminal death primes. We bring people into the lab, We have them read things on a computer, but unbeknownst to them, the word death is flashed from time to time so fast, 28 milliseconds, that you can't see anything. Right? All of the studies that I'm about to report, doesn't matter how you make people aware that they will die, the same outcome results. So in one of our original studies, we had Christian participants at the University of Arizona. We reminded some of their mortality, some of something unpleasant. And then we had them rate other people who were very similar, except some said they came from Christian families, others said that they came from Jewish families. In a controlled condition, momentarily restoring my faith in humanity, no difference in the evaluations of Christians and Jews by the Christian participants. However, after they were reminded of their mortality, they liked fellow Christians a lot more, and they hated Jewish people. Right, let's note, this has nothing to do with Christianity. To be silly, the five Jewish people in Arizona were busy that day. So we had to wait till Israeli psychologists asked Jewish people to think about death. And then they love Jewish people, they hate Christians and Arabs. And that basic effect has been reproduced in 25 countries on five different continents. Not only do death reminders influence your attitude, they also influence your behavior. Germans reminded of death sit closer to fellow Germans and further away from people who look like immigrants. Iranians reminded of their mortality become more supportive of suicide bombing and more willing to become one themselves. Americans, as you know, are crassly pragmatic. We're not about to blow ourselves up, but we're happy to blow up other people. And when we remind Americans of their mortality, they become more supportive of the use of biological, chemical, and nuclear weapons against countries who pose no direct threat to us. And this is particularly true of those who identify as conservative in terms of their political preferences. I like how George Bernard Shaw put it. Anyone know his work? I think it's in Hotel, that's right. Where's it? Heartbreak House. Where he says, when the angel of death sounds his trumpet, the pretenses of civilization are blown from men's heads into the mud like hats in a gust of wind. Right, let's keep going and let's talk about, as Ernest Becker was very concerned about, how it is that existential concerns can have radical effects on political preferences. Who's ever heard of the dead German sociologist Max Weber? I always recommend Weber for those of you having trouble sleeping as an excellent non-pharmacological intervention for insomnia. But well worth it, because Weber, at the beginning of the 20th century, he pointed out that in times of historical upheaval, we become profoundly attracted to a certain kind of leader. Who's heard the term charismatic leader? It was Weber who coined that term, and he defined the charismatic leader as a seemingly larger-than-life individual who is often believed either by themselves and or their followers as being divinely ordained to rid the world of evil. And a lot of people note that this is a good way of explaining how Hitler came to power. Again, who remembers that he was actually elected? And let's fast forward a bit. Yeah, he was. His party was elected. You don't have to like it, but that's what happened. We'll talk more about it. People good look and disagree. He didn't get a majority, but his party was elected. In fact, room deal. All right, no matter. Fast forward, September 11, 2001. Who remembers that day? I hope you all do. And who remembers that George W. Bush was president during that time? On September 10, 2001, President Bush had one of the lowest approval ratings in the history of presidential polling. Who remembers that? Look at the front page of the New York Times from the 10th on, or the 9th on Sunday, where they're like meeting to figure out what to do. They thought he was already a lame duck. 3 weeks later, the president has one of the highest approval ratings in the history of presidential politics. Why? Perhaps the president magically metamorphosized from a functionally illiterate oil industry neocon meat puppet into a dedicated civil servant capable of transcending monosyllabic utterance. Maybe. Maybe not, though. Maybe what happened is that the events of September 11th literally were like a mortality salience reminder in our experiments. And we did a boatload of experiments leading up to the 2004 presidential election, where we showed that Americans in benign states of mind did not care for President Bush or his policies in Iraq, but when they were reminded of their own mortality first, their support for the president and his policies skyrocketed. In fact, in one particularly discombobulating study, 5 weeks before the 2004 election, conducted at Rutgers University with registered voters who intended to vote, we just had some people think of dying, other people think of something unpleasant, and we just said, who are you going to vote for? Secret ballot, write it down. Well, in the control condition, our respondents said that they intended to vote for Senator Kerry by a 4-to-1 margin. However, if reminded of their mortality first, and these folks were randomly assigned to conditions, they said that they intended to vote for President Bush by an almost 3-to-1 margin. I wish we had more time to ponder the extraordinarily disconcerting implications of that finding. I don't care where you are on the political spectrum. This is not good for democracy when momentary alterations in psychological conditions are sufficient to prompt radical changes in political preferences. And we just did our first study on the charismatic leader du jour, Donald Trump. Now, Trump doesn't think that God has chosen him to rid the world of evil because he believes that God is his subordinate, but be that as it may, we have the same historical conditions in place as we have in 2001. You have the Paris attacks, you've got the San Bernardino shootings compounded by economic instability, and you have someone confidently proclaiming that he will make America great again. I'm going to build a big wall. I'm going to bomb the shit out of ISIS. And it's working. And we just did a study where, sure enough, reminders of death, and this was at the College of Staten Island, increased participants' support for Donald Trump and their willingness to vote for him. So, election coming up, New York Times, I wonder why they made their announcement today. But anyway, vote early, vote often. It's going to be an important election. I'm being silly. All right, let's switch gears and let's talk about how existential concerns foster contempt for nature and similar disregard for the environment. John Locke, remember John Locke's second treatise on government in 1690? Locke said, you know, anything of genuine value in the world, anything that's natural, is of finite duration. And therein lies the problem, the finitude of nature. And that, Becker says, is the psychological impetus for the construction of supernature. Right? After all, if we were content with our natural surroundings, there'd be no need to erect a symbolic superstructure to overcome the limitations of time and space. And because of that, Becker argues, when existential concerns are aroused, we become particularly uncomfortable with the fact that we're animals. And sure enough, when we remind people in our experiments that of their mortality, they deny vigorously that humans are animals. When we remind people of their mortality, they have extraordinarily more negative attitudes about animals and are more willing to kill them for reasons other than food and medical research. When we remind people of their mortality, they become uncomfortable with their own bodies and with natural bodily processes that are ordinarily quite pleasurable, like sex. When we remind people of their mortality, they become exceptionally uncomfortable in nature. Some Dutch psychologists showed Dutch people pictures of either nature or like New Jersey with like lawns and fences and hedges. And what they found was that in controlled conditions, people liked nature better than the burbs. But when people were reminded of their mortality first, they like the suburbs more than nature. Anyone read Frankenstein? Frankenstein talks a lot about how awful and terrifying raw nature is, when existential concerns are aroused. Finally, when people are reminded of their mortality, it makes them more greedy in terms of their willingness to exploit non-renewable natural resources. And our point, very simply, is I don't think we can understand humankind's disinclination to recognize the magnitude of our environmental problems without at least considering the role that existential concerns play. And of course, we can't talk about the destruction of the environment without also noting that human beings, at least in the West, are really preoccupied with an insatiable desire for money and stuff. I grew up in New York City, but I haven't been here for a while. Do people still go shopping? I'm being silly. And the point that Ernest Bandler makes is that any insatiable desire, right, anything natural, even if you love it, enough is enough. That's not true of money, and it's not true of stuff. Who remembers Tennessee Williams' Cat on a Hot Tin Roof? Big Daddy. The human animal is a beast that dies, and if he's got money, he buys and he buys and he buys. And I think the reason that he buys everything that he can buy is that in the back of his mind, he's got the crazy hope that one of his purchases will be life everlasting. Well, when we remind people of their mortality and ask them, how much money do you want? They say they want more money. When we remind people of their mortality and show them like newspaper ads for luxury items, they want more stuff. They don't want potato chips or cheap Chevys. They want a Lexus and a Rolex. When we remind people of their mortality and we just ask them, we didn't do this, some Polish psychologists did, we just ask them to draw pictures of coins or paper money, they actually draw bigger pictures. And we're not asking them to draw bigger pictures. We're saying, what does a coin look like? What does a dollar look like? Money literally looms larger on our minds when you're thinking about death. Finally, what the Polish people did was they gave people in their study either a stack of money, and they said, here, count this money, or they gave them a stack of blank pieces of paper, the same size as money, and they said, count the paper. Right, then they said, give it back. You didn't get to keep the money. And then they measured death anxiety. Just counting money was sufficient to reduce death anxiety. I don't know about you, but I think that is at least provocative. And let's talk about one more area, and this is why America is a petri dish of psychopathology. Who's aware that we have epidemic levels of a variety of psychological disorders right now in Los Estados Unidos? According to the National Institute of Mental Health, about 12% of Americans are currently depressed, upwards of a third will be depressed at some point in their lives. Another third of our population is addicted to drugs or alcohol. The final third, as we speak, are watching TV to see who can drink the most yak urine on Survivor, or they're in their SUVs looking for a Walmart to save a nickel on a chainsaw or a lemon. And silliness aside, what Ernest Becker says, and Martin Seligman, who's president of the American Psychological Association at one point, he says, look, whenever there's wholesale dis-ease in a culture, we need to look at the values that the culture embraces to see if they are realistically attainable by the average individual. Well, what is it that we value in our culture? Well, as many of you know, for guys particularly, although women are not spared this, we value money and power. Who, like me, grew up being taught the American dream? That if you work as hard and if you work hard and long, you can have as much money as Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, or Donald Trump. And of course, if you work very hard and you're 40 years old and you're wearing a polyester suit selling 3-pound burritos late night at Taco Bell, whose fault is that? Well, it's your fault. Right? But the reality, who's aware you're more likely to get out of poverty in Bangladesh than you are in America? And then my point is that we are setting our citizens up for psychological despair by asking them to embrace standards that cannot be realistically attained. Ditto for women, but they have it even worse because they're held accountable for standards of physical beauty that are literally impossible. Right? If you're not thinner than a piece of linguine, and if I can't floss my teeth with you, then you're too portly. Right now, the use-by date for women is getting younger and younger. If you're in your mid-20s, you're already, psychologically speaking, on the cusp of being over the hill. Right, so where are we? Well, according to Thomas Hardy, another famous novelist who I like a lot, Hardy said, if a way to the better there be, it comes from taking a close look at the worst. And I've certainly not spared you any of the downside of human affairs. I would argue that literally malignant manifestations of death anxiety bring out the worst in us. They make us depressed, hateful, warmongering, proto-fascist, plundering the planet in our insatiable quest for dollars and dross in a TV, alcohol, Facebook, drug-induced stupor. And although it pains me to say this, I don't think it's overly hysterical when a psychohistorian with the stature of Robert J. Lifton, anybody know Lifton's work? Well, he just said in the book Destroying the World to Save It that we're really arguably at a crossroads. We may be the first form of life to have the ignominious distinction of being responsible for our own extinction. Wow. I don't want to leave you though with that thought, because it's early and we need to be happy about lunch. So let me turn things around a bit and point out something that I believe sincerely to be the case, and that is that despite innumerable difficulties throughout our history, humans have a very good track record of extricating ourselves from a variety of seemingly daunting difficulties once we understand what it is that underlies them. So who remembers the plague in the Middle Ages? Once again, not because we were there, although some of us look like we might have been, but the point is, myself included, but the point is that who remembers that we thought plague was caused by evil spirits? Who remembers that? So we have exorcisms and stuff. How'd that work? Not too good. But then we realized that the plague was caused by bacteria. And once we realized what was really going on, well, that led to the invention of penicillin and the development of modern medicine, without which more than half of us would not be here. We'd be taking the proverbial dirt nap at the cemetery. Well, I believe that this is good news, because if we can collectively, as well as individually, take stock of ourselves and begin to recognize and acknowledge how our own existential terror causes some of the most pernicious difficulties that now currently befall us, I think this puts us in good shape to deploy our remarkable ingenuity to minimize, if not completely eradicate, the destructive tendencies that our existential fears can and often do unleash. And getting back to Camus, one of my favorites, he scribbled in one of his notebooks, "Come to terms with death, thereafter anything is possible." Overstatement, perhaps, but I think it's on the right track, even as an unattainable ideal. I think that's it. I thank you a great deal for your time and attention, and I hope you enjoyed it.